expecting some feedback from that imminently. The bit in terms of where we are as a place, again, the consensus where we are an established place, I think we need to do some work around how we develop the place-based partnership borders. There's some new members around there, and we need to make sure that we make what we do understandable to the public and understandable to those members. We have some more work to do about ensuring that the supporting groups feeding that have the appropriate representation upon them. So again, some work with the voluntary community trade sector. And we also want to make sure that we have place-focused reporting tools. So a finance plan and report for place, a performance report for place. And we are tracking some of the outcomes and metrics that we need to do for Wirral, as well as contributing to the wider Cheshire and Merseyside footprint. So we bring these reports here so we have a strategic oversight, but we continue to use the place-based partnership board as the means through which we will conduct the business. And over a period of time, it is our hope that will then start to get more delegated authority from NHS Cheshire and Merseyside. So it is not just Cheshire and Merseyside making decisions with the council, it's every partner in the room. So we're starting off with that in terms of making sure as many people are around the table, but also we're engaging with as many people outside of that room as we possibly can in the development of our plans. And one of the things we will be doing, and I've sent a hold of the date out today, is in early December we're hoping to get all our NHS provider partners, the council, primary care and the voluntary community faith sector into a room to look at preview our investment plans 2023-24. As we know, it's going to be a tight financial year. We know we've got a number of commitments we need to meet from in this financial year, and we are anticipating, probably subject to the fiscal statement coming forward from the Chancellor within the next couple of weeks, we're then anticipating further guidance to help and care about what other priorities we may need to seek to meet. So it's effectively setting out openly with people the things we're already doing, the outcomes we're getting from them, and how much resource is needed for them, and then actually saying, so what do we know what's coming in next year in terms of resource, what's the envelope we need to live within, and what else do we need to deliver, and then that will enable the place-based partnership board to develop a clear plan about how, why and when. I think that's it.
Thank you for helping to on paper. I think it's really complex, I have to say. Basically kind of very toxic to begin with. I'm just trying to work out over new health centre. What's my actual name?
It's Steve Barclay.
Okay.
So Steve Barclay was the health secretary before the last health secretary, temporarily.
Musical chairs
then. As I understand it, he's mastering the brief very quickly.
Okay. So it's not to read a copy then. I was fascinated by the concept of the world. If the world was a village of 100 people, what would it look like? So I'm going to put you on the spot now and ask you to give us some top lines. What would it look like?
I think I'll just have to quickly find the website.
Just put it.
It's now as well being
started. Does anyone else want to ask time or comments? Okay. Okay, well, it's
I think that the workshop in Sunday 2 days is going to be quite a good workshop because I think as a system, the whole system, what we've seen is increased costs right across the board. We're struggling to meet population demand, but we have a hospital that is bursting at the seams in terms of social care. We're struggling to meet our social care needs across the board. And our system continues to do the same things. And I think that there is a requirement on us to deal with some of these problems in different ways, and that certainly we aspire to support an increasing number of people out of hospital in the community through wards in the community, better wards in the community, through any fair schemes in the borough. I'd be interested to see how that goes, because I think it really is time for us to drive some kind of new models of work to make those shifts in gear.
Thank you for that. So I'm just going to move that we know the report. Do I have a second for that?
A second.
Okay, and also we have the recommendations are there. So we know the report and endorse the place director, that the place director coordinates the submission of the Cheshire and Merseyside Health and Care Partnership strategy in consultation with the Director of Public Health, and that the submission will be based upon information contained in the Rural Health and Living Strategy 2022-27. And that we consider the Cheshire and Merseyside Health and Care Partnership strategy as a future meeting. So are you happy to second that? Thank you. Happy to be up by a sense. Thank you. Moving on to the next agenda item, which is 7. And that is Town Deal for Birkenhead and Sally.
Thank you, Chair. Just a very brief introduction and hand over to Kate. You'll recall as a board member that we submitted a town deal bid back in 2021, and we were for the town deal programme as part of the Department for Levelling Up Housing Communities programmes. And we were successful and were awarded £25 million. It's a focus on largely, I suppose you could say, sort of outcomes to do with our thriving and inclusive economy. But however, as part of that, there really are significant health outcomes that are delivered through that programme. And I'd just like to hand over to Kate to provide an update on the programme today.
Thank you, Sally. Thank you, Chair. I'm Kate Pearce, I'm the Economic Development Lead for the Town Deal programme. You've invited me today to give you some background on the Town Deal programme, which I will do, and then I'll pass over to Lee Pennington from Open Door Charity and David Hammond from the NHS. Community Health and Foundation Care Trust, who are delivering on one of our town deal programmes. So, as Sally said, last year the Department of Levelling Up Housing Communities invited the Council to enter into a town deal for Birkenhead. And this will see up to £25 million invested in capital schemes across the town. And the objective of a town deal is to create jobs and opportunities and develop a thriving and inclusive economy for Birkenhead. And town deal also supports bespoke training in specific growth areas such as music and The next outcome provides flexible workspace across a range of sectors. So we will have co-working and collaboration and incubation spaces, and these provide support to small businesses. For example, MakeCIC's new makerspace will provide support for creative entrepreneurs. We'll have flexible terms that give businesses the option to trial new things. So Startyard are already doing this, offering flexible terms to help small business startups and thereby reducing risk. And finally, Towndeal will deliver on new and improved creative and cultural facilities. And support for the culture and creative sector is a key theme of our Towndeal programme. We know that a visit to a museum or cultural facility is found to have a significant impact on mental well-being. The transport shed will provide an opportunity for visitors to engage with the past, providing social interaction and sharing of stories in an environment that will bring about positive emotion. Creative interventions can positively distract from clinical environments, and the Joy Project will embed culture and creativity and mental health. So that's my overview to our Towndeal programme. I'd now like to pass over to Lee and David to tell you more about the Joy Project. This project has secured £3.98 million through Towndeal. And Joy will not feel like a traditional health centre, but will bring together health, arts and cultural sectors.
Thanks for having us along today. building on what we said last time, what Paige just said, I mean, The brief behind Joy really is to blow up our traditional thinking up in like how health and wellness and well-being is born really, and the types of places that services can live and exist and are those things. And the idea being that if you combine those worlds with the world of, you know, form and colour and joy and like career enrichment and having a good time and socialising and you know, community support, and if you combine all those worlds, you give the best chance each of those different worlds to really achieve the best possible outcome just by being combined. And the opportunity with Joy is to physically combine those things and to like have a resource, a place, right in the heart of Wirral that just shines a light on progressive and where innovation can like truly reflect not only like, you know, what, you know, good ideas in the public, it's sort of totally community driven. So the third sector is going to be an absolute sort of cornerstone of the project. And again, the enhancement, you know, the opportunity within like the NHS to sort of allow the NHS to speak a different language to the public and allow it to exist and deliver its services in a different fabric. So there's a million and one different routes of travel and things coming out of Joy, which over the last year we've tried to sort of begin the process of exploring and building, and we've spent, you know, the past since the turn of the year generally like engaging with the public in numerous different ways on quite a, you know, large scale to find out what is needed, what people think would work, what people, you know, think could truly be achieved if you know, we rip up the rules and all this sort of thinking. At the same time as getting people excited and getting people behind the idea, because this idea can't be the success that we are fully convinced that it will be if it's just led by Open Door Charity and the NHS Trust or anything like that. It needs people to feel like it's a coming together and it's a communal space. So the engagement process was great. At the same time, alongside that, we used that engagement and all the stuff that we learned to influence the design. So we worked with the design team, quantity surveyor, you know, conversation around that now. We didn't have that last time, and you know, at first you think, well, that's a long time, not really. That's actually a big asset to the project, because there's so many moving parts and so many relationships and stakeholders that we need to sort of nurture and like work out the best way to move forward. Is that that period of time gives us the best chance of doing being a bit successful within that. But it doesn't mean we don't do anything, you know, it's not like close to the draw on it for 2 years or anything like that. I think it's time to, the plan is to ramp up engagement further. I think, you know, people, things and organisation within organisations across Wirral, I think, you know, the last year has done a good job of getting people excited about the idea. You know, people are feeling, you know, people are asking me like daily about, you know, what comes next, what, you know, what's next steps look like, how can we be involved, you know, give us more detail type of thing. So I think the purpose of 2023 is about like doing some programming which explores and, you know, trials and road tests some of the quite innovative and quite different concepts and things and services that we project are going to be included within Joy. It's about taking them out to the world, and by doing so, you'll build that excitement, you'll build that game, as well as the idea will be road tested. So what we land on this time of the year's time is like, it's absolutely wonderfully clear on the things that are going to work within Joy, or the things that are a good idea now that maybe haven't got legs, or people thought we wanted, but they, you know, haven't wanted, or anything like that. It'll be, we'll have a collective and a Joy vision, which is totally informed by road testing and evidence and trial and error. As well as, like, you know, people, they say a couple of few words in the set, but it's like, as well as the relationships that need to take, that need to be built and need to be like built into Joy around, you know, within the NHS or within social care or, you know, or whatever that is, it gives us time to make that the best it can be. Is there anything you wanted to add in there?
Yeah, thank you. I'm here for Cameron Terry, but also as the NHS lead for Joy, which is a wonderful project to be involved with. We won't go through the report that's in the pack, but I would like to draw his attention to it, because it highlights all the engagement and the design work, the development work that went on last year, and just to, I think, highlight the quality of some of that engagement and the involvement of organisations like Qualitative and Cheshire and Hardship Trust. There's some very detailed work done with people with a whole range of kind of particular needs and wants, and that's been absolutely built into the design. So the centre is fundamentally built around inclusion. So it's going to be a really exciting and I think different, something we've not seen in Wirral, and perhaps actually, you know, in developing this, me and the team, we went out and looked at lots of examples around the country. And I say, well, a few, there's not that many. We absolutely anticipate in 3 years' time people will be coming to Wirral to look at the example of how you design a building and a space and an offer that brings together all the things that Lee was talking about. On page 62 of the pack, there's a diagram, and it talks about different reasons why people would be getting engaged with Joy as a place. So whether it's coming for NHS services or wider health and wellbeing offer, whether it's about social pleasure, work and learning, it's all of those things. And then we first put forward the outline case. We brought together two ideas from Open Door and from the Health and Wellbeing Task and Finish Group. The phrase of one door opening many was fundamental to it, and that ethos is absolutely continuing through into the design. And I think the last thing for me to say is, I think it seems like a long way off, but it is an asset that we've got 2023 to do this further developmental work, because part of it is about bringing together all of the various teams who've been so excited in the engagement so far, to look in terms of how we would develop these well-coordinated teams and this well-coordinated offer, where it doesn't feel like you're coming for one thing and that's it, you know, you go and leave as a service provider or as a person who's going there for something in particular. It's about entering an environment where lots of different things are possible. So that's a real opportunity actually for us during 2023 to do that work, so it's a really exciting time.
Just one or two small report things to just raise. It says in the report where the planning application has been submitted, and it mentions well about like funding shortfall. And we're going to be in as well, recruiting the first member staff who's going to like lead on, actually like delivering the joy idea, taking away ownership away from what something for the last, what for the last year's felt like me and Dave sort of doing a lot of. We'll still be obviously closely involved, but you know, it's starting to become a thing rather than an outlook of ideas on a piece of paper.
Thank you. I mean, as someone who's born in Birkenhead still lives there, it's just an absolute joy to see that part and what's happened to it. And it just absolutely highlights the community-driven sort of approach. When we remove something like health and wellbeing solely from the desert of clinical settings and put it back into the community, it just leads the way. So I'm absolutely bowled over by this and what's happening in Birkenhead generally, and what the work you've been doing over the years as well. You have to, you know, credit to yourself there. I think this is amazing. It really is. And it's indicative, isn't it, of lots of things now. It's like so progressive and it's a different model of doing things and a better, it's like organic and it's a better way of doing things. Much for me. I think, well, it is, anyway. So I just want to thank you for that. That was so interesting. And I can't wait to come down and I've got a little nosy. So, does anyone want to say anything? Or, yeah, Elizabeth?
Thanks, Chair. And just a comment really from Children's Services perspective. Just on page 80, one of the reports looking at key partners. For those of you that looked at it, you'll see that Royal Council Children's Services confirmed. And I know we've had conversations about this, but just it's not our commitment to the programme that needs to be confirmed. We are committed to it, but just building on what you were saying about, Chair, about innovation and organic, we've not decided yet what services we might deliver from it. We're kind of waiting, aren't we, to see what the need might be, how joy develops, and then we'll make some agreement about what services we deliver from it. But we are fully committed to it.
The commitment's there, it's just to be decided.
I think that's again one of the important parts of engagement. It's two way, isn't it? And it's about, you know, in 2 years' time, what we can't predict what, okay, well, it's the service that we want to be delivering, but it's about making sure that the conversation's ongoing and the leader. So it's like when the opportunity is there, the time's right, oh, what the hell, that service needs to be in that sort of arena.
Sam?
Just two quick things. I think this does absolutely fit in the whole, you know, regeneration of Birkenhead and the borough agenda. I think also we're focusing on the joy project. There's also some really other exciting projects in here that also connect and fit into that. The other question is more as a statement, the question is, do you need some assistance in terms of accessing primary care networks in this? Because you mentioned in the paper around joy, do you want to engage with the PCNs, the primary care networks and local practices in this?
That would be, it's something we've started, it's something we'd like to do a lot more of, so yes, sign that would be good, particularly with some of the additional roles in primary care networks with social prescribers, health coaches and those sorts of roles. It's something we absolutely envisage being part and parcel of the offer, and with two PCM teams at Birkenhead, it would be great to take that to the next stage as we get into 2024.
I think where you mentioned two PCN teams, there's one primary care network and two service delivery units, and for me, they said Birkenhead, regardless of how they're organised. So I think there's about getting them in the room and saying, how do you work together to serve the people of Birkenhead, and specifically linking to programmes like this. So we'll pick it up outside, David.
Really wanted to say, well, say thank you, but also to say that in terms of, I think this project is such a good example of showing the, as is the approach that we're taking for regeneration, and that it is often, yes, this obviously is about a building and making sure that the building is sort of reflects, but it's not just, oh, we're putting up something new and shiny. The way in which you're designing it is absolutely based on what the communities and the residents and stakeholders need in Birkenhead, and I think that really sort of is the approach that we're trying to take for our regeneration around that whole place shaping. That it's not just about individual projects, it's not just about buildings, it's very much about how
except for starting on grassroots Wirral residents who've like started something in the bedroom and you know the book will be whatever it is, it's about taking that next step. And what this represents is yourselves and investing in those people with those ideas to take that next step, isn't it? Which is like part of the same conversation.
Absolutely. We'll have the Guardian back up here before we know it. They said Birkenhead was the place to be a few months ago, one of their articles. So you have them back up.
There was a Guardian article as well, which maybe I'll probably say it if we can circulate it, I'm sure the way there. There was a really interesting Guardian article as well, which was like the front page on the Guardian as well. Was it the one?
Yeah, the place to be, isn't it?
Birkenhead.
Great as well. We've got some really well-deserved positive feedback there. So thank you both for that, really interesting. And I think it just highlights, maybe it's just confirmed to me that the Health and Wellbeing Board, this is exactly the direction we need to be going in, and we all know. So I'm going to move that report and the update to have a second look at that. Yeah, thanks, Kathy. Can we read by a sense? Okay, thank you. Look forward to your next update as well, by the way. And we have now agenda item 8, which is Qualitative Insight Programme, and that's yourself.
Thank you, Chair. My name is Lisa Jones, and I'm one of the senior public health managers within the public health team of the council. I'm bringing the report today to update the board on Wirral's Qualitative Insight team, and the paper outlines the proposed work plan, which supports the delivery of the health and wellbeing strategy. And I think this probably leads quite nicely on from the conversation that we've just had around listening to local people and help them using that to inform our actions and proposals. So a key strand of the strategy, it really recognises the importance of communities, listening to them and really working with them to deliver the strategy. Key to this is strengthening our relationships and ensuring the voice of communities shape local action and responses. And I think this was really a key learning from the pandemic and some of the work that we did with the humanitarian staff. We really recognised through that work the importance of local voices, working with our community voluntary and faith sector and communities. And we really used that to really shape our response to the pandemic and some of our communications back out. And it was really invaluable. Historically, public health have commissioned a number of pieces of work through external agencies to really look at specific topics. An example of this is the work that we did with Sally's team and the investment team around health-related worklessness. And again, that's really helped inform some of our commissions, like the Reach Out work, which we heard about earlier, also our Community Connector contract, which we're all aware of. However, we recognised that this wasn't really an efficient approach. And we were able, through contained outbreak management funding, to secure 2 years of funding to develop an in-house function to be able to perform this. The Qualitative Insight team is based within the public health team, but it works across all directorates in the organisation. It consists of 8 members of staff, all with specialised skills. They are able to collate, synthesise, analyse and disseminate insights to help deliver the health and wellbeing strategy and the Wirral plan. There's 4 key areas of the work plan, one of which is supporting the development and ongoing monitoring of the strategy. Delivery of insight to support the current cost of living work programme and work across the council to support the regeneration programmes like the work that we just heard about and some of the master planning work that's being undertaken. And also to support some of the commission services. I know the team are undertaking some work for children's currently looking at the risk-taking behaviours there. What I would say is, although they are 4 standalone pieces of work, as you will see, they cross-cut a lot of the strategy and really feed into all the themes across the health and wellbeing strategy. The team have been in post since June and have already undertaken a number of key pieces of work. Specifically relating to the cost of living, they've undertaken a number of case studies with local people to really get under the skin and understand how people are being affected by the cost of living, and they've developed some videos to support that work. In terms of the health and wellbeing strategy, they've undertaken a piece of work collating and synthesising This morning I've had a presentation from the team around work they've done with Together All We're Able, the great piece of work, which really looks at how we can ensure the voice of our most vulnerable residents are heard and informed in our health and wellbeing strategy. All of this work is available on Rural Intelligence Work Service website. The plans in year two is to try and create a training programme across the partnership, recognising that a lot of the agencies sat around this table are collecting insights on a daily basis. We're speaking to local people, and how do we use that as a central repository to really inform what we're doing as a board and as part of the strategy. The team have made really strong links with Wirral Intelligence Service, and we've aligned both teams' work plans, and the proposal is to bring regular joint updates back to this board to help inform the development of the strategy. And we're also looking to develop some qualitative indicators. So not only do we have quantitative indicators, but we'll have sort of that voice of the people around sort of the monitoring of the strategy. The team work programme will be fully evaluated, and we've made links with the local government agency around their behavioural insights programme, and they're really keen to understand how the team works and how it pans out over the 2 years. We'll be working with the LGA and the board here today to try and look at sustainability of the team moving forward past the 2 years.
Thank you. I was just thinking about, one of the things that jumped out to me was on the outcomes, there's a faster response to societal changes at the world. That's just, it's at the moment, there's so much going on, isn't it? And, I was out with Community Connectors a few weeks ago in Wiscard, speaking to residents, and what I noticed there, that it's somebody who works, but has got grown up kids, and he's not in a traditional, what you would call traditionally vulnerable or financially vulnerable, but he was really, really struggling. But he was kind of that group that doesn't qualify for any assistance currently. Yeah, I think so. Things are changing all the time, aren't they? So I'm really pleased to see that we're going to be responding to that.
Yeah, and I think some of the work that we've done around hospital and gently captures that, and we've fed it in through the health cell, through Simon and that work. But it's really great in terms of that quick response to some of their societal issues to really help us inform what we're doing in terms of, to really help to inform some of the criteria around the CBF cost of living grants that we've just launched as well.
Okay, anyone have anything
you want to ask? I think the work that's been put together so far in relation to neighbourhoods and the profiles of what's happening at the neighbourhood level and kind of the level of need, all of those sorts of things are going to be really helpful for us in the future as we work as a system in a much more sort of localised way.
This feels like a really positive step, because it's often struck me that when it comes to understanding people's experience of NHS services, we start from out of the wrong end of the telescope. It comes from a service perspective. How did you experience our service, rather than what was your experience? And a bit of that was our service, but a bit of that was someone else's, and a whole bit of it was about your life. It's not about services at all. And how are we understanding that, and then taking the bit that we need to improve the service that we provide? So I know you've done some examples around work that's been done in our commission services, but hopefully that would be understanding the totality, but then understanding a bit later in the service. And I think collectively as providers we should be able to really draw on that when it comes to understanding what matters to people, so we can put an appropriate response in place.
And I think the more we develop this work, that's more what we're finding, that actually they're not distinct pieces of work that we're doing. So for instance, the rest of taking behaviours work and the sexual health work that we're doing actually across puts both, and it will inform so much of the strategy in terms of the work that we're doing.
Beautiful, thank you. Okay, so Simon?
Nick, is this speaking to the Core 20 plus 5 and the Qualities Group that Nesta chairs?
We haven't moved in so far, Simon, but we can absolutely do that.
All right then, well, thank you everyone. So I'm going to move the recommendation, which is the Health and Wellbeing Board, notice the developments of the Wirral Qualitative Institute. where for an old date, and it's all there, the page 97 to 98. So I'm going to move that we notice the web programme. I've got a second there, thank you. Can you agree my assent? Thank you, everyone. Do we have to go on next meeting?
It's a sorry. Institutions, I think that would probably need to be delayed until February. It's on both anyway.